حضرتك اتفضل.
تمام
اهلا وسهلا.
تمام السلام عليكم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. هنتكلم عن الموضوع ان شاء الله. شكرا لدكتور خالد اولا على التقديم، وشكرا على المباركه، والله يخليك. وان شاء الله هنتكلم عن الموضوع ده، الموضوع ده يهمنا جدا كفونياتريشن، لان ده رول اوف فونياتريشن في التراكيوسوم ديكانيليشن از فيري امبورتنت. وطبعا احنا بنقدر نوري شغلنا، لان هو ده اللي هيثبت يعني كفاءتنا وقدرتنا. ده انا بالنسبه لي ان انا شغلي هو اللي بيبيني، مش ولا بورق ولا باي شيء معايا. فالجزء ده مهم جدا، لان ده خاص بالفونياتريشن، ما فيش اي حد تاني يقدر يتدخل بيه غير طبعا احنا الاوتولارنجولوجي. احنا بارت من الاوتولارنجولوجي، يعني احنا هنا عندنا احنا تيم من الاوتولارنجولوجي، وانا ماسك التراكيوسوم ديكانيليشن تيم في دبي هوستل. فهنتكلم على التراكيوسوم ديكانيليشن. طبعا هو في انترودكشن شويه سريع عن التراكيوسومي طبعا والانديكيشن بتاعتها. فالانديكيشن وي هاف ا لوت اوف انديكيشن فور تراكيوستومي، ودي ذا موست كومن سيرجيكال اوبريشن. طبعا يعني اكتر حاجه بنعملها في الاي ام تي از ميكانيكال اوبستراكشن، لكن من ناحيتنا احنا في العيانين النيوروجينيك بيشنت بيبقى المين انديكيشن از بروتكشن اوف تراكيوبرينكال تري في البيشنت اوف ريسك اوف اسبيريشن. نيوروجينيك بيشنت عين لانه ستروك الكلام ده كله. البرولونجد ميكانيكال فنتيليشن طبعا برضو وان اوف ذا موست كومن كوز في العيان، عشان يعملوا ويننج من الاندو تراكيال تيوب، فبالتالي بيعملوا له تراكيوستومي عشان ديشارج من الاي سي يو. معظم العيانين عشان طبعا في الاي سي يو هيتنوا انتوبيتد، فعشان يطلعهم اي سي يو، خصوصا في ايام الكورونا الفتره اللي فاتت دي كان العيانين بيتعمل لهم التراكيوستومي بعد اسبوع من الاي سي يو. في العادي كان ممكن بيعادوا المريض لاسبوعين وثلاثه لان في مكان في الاي سي يو. فحاليا طبعا زاد الريت على الاي سي يو، فبالتالي بيعملوا تراكيوستومي وديشارج البيشنت عشان يقدر يعملوا ويننج من الميكانيكال فنتيليشن. طبعا التراكيوستومي بتقلل الديد سبيس في الابر اير واي، بتقلل الايفورت تو بريسنج، ولا فبالتالي هي بتعمل ريليز للاوبستراكشن في الابر اير واي، فتمنع. فاقدر اعمل عن طريقها برولونج ميكانيكال فنتيليشن، بروتكت فروم اسبيريشن، وباي باز ذا اوبستراكشن. اولسو سام تايم انديكيتد ان بيشنت تو جاست ريليز اوف اسبيريشن، يعني تو ساكشن اوف اسبيريشن، I have to put the tracheostomy tube for suction of fluids. طبعا this advantage بتعمل dry mucus secretion و mucus plugs, disturbance of mucociliary clearance mechanism, فده طبعا بيعمل dryness في secretion و stagnation of the secretion. بتأثر على swallowing هنتكلم عنها بعدين. وفي aspiration و pooling of secretion above the cavity tube. نتيجة طبعا بيحصل حاجة اسمها desensitization of the larynx. فالعين عنده response لل presence of saliva on the larynx is defected. So the patient cannot cough. Even also there is loss of airway. So no subglottic airway active, no airway for go through the glottis. So it affect also the cough reflex. Also there is some granuloma formation, and we'll give example later on. There is different type of tube. So most of the patient at the start of the tracheostomy we do cavity the tube for newly formed stoma for post pressure ventilation. طبعا cough and cough pressure can be measured by different method. Uncuff the tube later on if the patient have only obstruction, mechanical obstruction, mainly vocal cord cord palsy or head and neck tumor. So the patient only need to bypass the upper airway obstruction, but has good management of his own saliva. So we can both uncuff tube. Unfenestrated tube is step decannulation stage, because we decrease the size of the tube and make fenestrate tube to both speaking valve and to start capping after that for gradual decannulation. In swallowing, the effective tracheostomy itself, other than the cause, most of our patients are neurogenic patients, so they have other cause of swallowing disorder, neurogenic dysphagia. But in addition to that, there is effect of tracheostomy itself, mechanical impact due to most intracheal intubation. The patient has prolonged mechanical intubation, which caused edema and distalization of the larynx and the pharynx, blunting in response to material entering the airway and result in aspiration. And also restriction of laryngeal elevation is very important. The laryngeal elevation is very important for cric pharyngeal function. So there will be cric pharyngeal spasm and the patient cannot, there is a stagnation of bolus and aspiration. Also, there in severe cases, the obstruction of the esophagus due to overinflated cuff. So this is the mechanical impact. The physiological impact, as we say, there is loss or reduction of airflow into the upper airway. So cough reflex is absent. Absent smell and taste is very important also for sensory stimulation of the swallowing. Altered airway pressure, subglottic air pressure and pharyngeal air pressure is affected due to no airflow in the upper airway. And loss of reduction airflow through the larynx also. All of this cause physiological impact on swallowing. All this, if the patient is mechanical, yani the cause of tracheostomy is mechanical, but if the cause is neurogenic, there is other factors causing dysphagia in this patient. The first test you have to do for patient coming to you for tracheostomy decanulation assessment. The patient referred to us, the patient with tracheostomy referred for you for checking for tracheostomy decanulation fitness and the swallowing assessment. So the first we have to do is the cough deflation test. Cough deflation test is very simple. We have to do, most of the patient come with inflated cough, so we have to release the air by cough deflation, removing the air from by syringe. It's mainly the average is 10 ml. So we remove the air and check the response of the patient. Most of the patient at the start, there's some irritation because the movement of the balloon itself in the trachea cause irritation of the trachea. So you have to wait 1 minute, the patient will cough, and after that you check the response. If there is increased cough more than one minute, okay, fatigue and increased oxygen concentration, desaturation of the patient, so the patient will, in this way, is failed the cannulation, failed cough deflation test. Because we have to do swallowing assessment with inflated cough or deflated cough. This question, there's a lot of study in this point to do swallowing assessment with cough inflated or deflated. There is many and controversy in the response, but the most recent studies say there is no difference between inflated or deflated cuff during swallowing assessment. This is from my reading in this subject. So we can do with, but from my experience, I do with deflated cuff. It's very important to release the pressure, to allow air flow, to increase subglottic air flow, so the cuff reflex will be working. But in inflated cuff, the reflex will be lower. So, and after cuff deflation, and you have to check the tube size also, because the tube may be large size. So the tube already obstructing the airway if you make deflation, and you try to make a finger occlusion test. Finger occlusion, we close the stoma finger by finger, the tube, okay, and ask the patient to phonate or cuff. So if air will pass around the tube and the patient can phonate or cough, and you can assess the voice of the patient. If there is gurgling, there is maybe salivary pooling. And if clear voice, this is a good indication for the next step of swallowing assessment. So this is the cough deflation test. After that, for clinical swallowing assessment, bedside swallowing assessment, knows the patient. Most of this patient, we do first bedside swallowing assessment. The first and the most important is the vigilance of the patient and the response of the patient, general neurological status of the patient. If the patient is aroused and responding and reacting, so this is good indication. Most of the patient with low consciousness state and low arousal state mainly hinder the decanulation process. We have to observe the swallowing of spontaneous swallow of saliva. And able to swallow secretion, cough efficiently. So all of this is the clinical bedside, like normal bedside swallowing assessment. There is simple back test we can do for salivary aspiration. For salivary aspiration, that's called the blue dye test. Just we put 0.1 ml of blue dye into the mouth, and the patient will swallow his own saliva and leave the patient for 10 minutes or 15 minutes. And we have to check after that the secretion suction through the tube, or cough through the tube, or leaking around the tube, or around the stoma, maybe all staining of the goose around the stoma. So all this indicate there is penetration of saliva to in this patient. But this test is not specific, because most of the patients have stained secretion in the glottis because there is, as we said before, desensitization, and there is minor aspiration occur for most of the tracheostomy patient. So not all patients, if it is severe, if you find only remnant, you can continue with the patient. It's not true aspiration. It is mainly mild aspiration. after that, as we said, for clinical bedside assessment, the some patient has neurophysiological deficits. The patient has aphasia, disoriented, the coma scale is low. So we'll guide and we'll judge on him as he's not fit for decannulation and they can postpone decannulation. That's why the importance of endoscopic assessment. Endoscopic assessment, you can observe criteria for decannulation without looking for the neurological condition of the patient or response of the patient. And it is mainly objective, not subjective criteria. So endoscopic evaluation, I'll give you simple steps for that. طبعا, you know the fees, طبعا, all of us know the fees. But here there is a specific modification for fees. The patient have to examine in sitting position. First, you have to check the patient management of his own saliva. In this endoscopic examination, I have to look for three important points. Management of his own secretion, the patency of the airway, and swallowing assessment, normal swallowing assessment. So we have to check two extra points. Management of his own secretion, if there's salivary pooling or not. And there's طبعاً, stays, and scaling for salivary pooling. Second is the spontaneous swallowing. The patient has spontaneous swallow within 2 minutes, have to be at least one time every 2 minutes. And third point is laryngeal sensitivity and cuff reflex. So we have to touch the epiglottic fold so the patient can have to have some cuff or reaction. So here there is mild salivary pooling, and this may be observed in patient, but will not stop us because only 25% in the piriform, and there is some penetration, no true aspiration. Here, more severe. There is overfilling of the piriform and filling the going to the glottis, and there is penetration and aspiration to the glottis. This more clear. There is, but the patient has a spastic larynx. But do you check the spontaneous swallow? So you find blind time. So you can check the patient has a spontaneous swallow. As we said, there is salivary pooling and aspiration scaling. Some cases, but you have to so you have to check the airway. So this patient has epiglottic collapse. This is very common finding. We find in many patients, there is prolonged collapse of the epiglottis, closing of the epiglottis, closing the laryngeal inlet. So the patient, in this case, we wait till the spasm released. It is released now, and the epiglottis appear, and we can check the vocal fold, normal mobility, no salivary pooling. But this patient, if you remove the tricuspid, may get this spasm and they will get stridor. So one of the causes of the stridor post decannulation is the epiglottis spasm. So we have to assess during our examination. To complete the endoscopic examination, we complete as normal swallowing assessment by urine consistency and water, colored water. And we have to observe for silent aspiration. So as normal swallowing. The first three steps we did, first for management of saliva and the cuff reflex and the spontaneous swallow. If the patient is okay in all the three steps, so the patient is fit for decannulation from the swallowing site. Even if the patient cannot swallow the urine consistency or other consistency, because we have to differentiate between fitness for decannulation and the fitness for oral feeding in this point. This is a very important point because a lot of patient cannot swallow, so we cannot remove the tracheostomy. I saw hundreds of patients of that characteristic come from any centers, a lot of centers, the rehabilitation centers, the patient is permanent tracheostomy because he cannot swallow. If this criteria is okay, we can remove the tracheostomy, and we remove already tracheostomy in a lot of patients of this type, and the patient can go with big. So the patient, if the patient with tracheostomy is disabling more than big, so I prefer to remove the tracheostomy and keep the patient by big feeding. It's okay, no problem for that. طبعا this is as usual swallowing assessment, but we use yogurt and mainly easily to be seen, and there is penetration till the level of the vocal fold, and the patient has a cough reflex. So we examine the swallow. We have to examine the airway also. So we examine the airway, we see the vocal fold and the respiratory change, but we can't see the, so we see the airway above the vocal fold. We want to see the airway from the tube to the vocal fold, or subglottic area till the tube. So we examine it by two ways, either downward, from down. So how can we examine from down? We go from the tracheostomy through the tube, and we look up. You will see here the vocal fold inverted, opening and closing, but inverted manner. Do you see here? There is and clear airway, no subglottic granuloma. This not for shaking the mobility of the vocal fold, but check the clearance of the airway, no subglottic granuloma, and no. From other side, we can see from up. I can go down. I assess the vocal fold. After swallowing assessment, I put xylocaine. And we irrigate the patient with xylocaine, so the patient can respond. Halas, we're not examining reflex now. We examine the airway, so anatomical. So we'll go down. I can see the tube and the subglottic area, and the trachea ring is free. So this patient is airways okay. Sometime you can go down, you find collapse, subglottic collapse is collapse of anterior wall. So this, if you remove the tracheostomy, this airway will not be sufficient for the patient. Also there is some patient having supratubal granulation tissue, you find granulation tissue. According to the size of granulation tissue is affecting, if affecting more than 50% or of the airway, so the patient is not fit. We have to manage this either by laser, but most of the patient recovered by follow-up, and the corticosteroid spray sometime we bought. After that, we can examine through the tracheostomy itself to see the trachea and tell the carina. We can say, and you find the airway is clear, no granulation tissue. Here there is small kidapetike from this suction tube, sometimes cause injury to the trachea and carina. When you go through the tracheostomy, you can find through the tracheostomy tube, this is fenestrated tube, as you see the fenestra were going down. We can find this granulation tissue at the end of the tube. So the patient has a tracheostomy and has difficulty in breathing at the same time because this one is obstructing the airway. So how we manage this one? From our experience, most of these patients are neurogenic patient and elderly patient. So operation this way is very difficult because they cannot even put the tube. So always what we do is to make shorter tube. So we release the pressure on the or attachment to the granulation, it recover. And sometimes we do adjustable flanks tube, more longer tube, if it can pass here, so it can pass the tube and the patient follow up, because it will press this granulation, it will and will decrease. A lot of patient would do this adjustable flangable tube. Another one was also a granulation, subtubal granulation. This one is small granulation, and you can pass here. So if you remove the tube up, this tube will, the airway will be open. Another case by severe, you see, the patient come to us like this. Wait, in this patient, we manage by adjustable flange, shorter, smaller tube, smaller in diameter, but longer. And we enter in this area and it can pass. And the patient, because the patient is very old, it was 85 years old. Maybe find some time in the fenestra of the tracheostomy tube, you find some granulation tissue growing through the fenestra. So it's very important when removing the tube or changing the tube in fenestra, you have to shake the tracheostomy itself because the granulation, this will cause bleeding in this patient. all some patient will go through the trachea, you find tracheal collapse. يعني tracheomalacia or mainly tracheal collapse because it comes from the posterior wall, not cartilage here. No cartilage here, so it's collapse in the posterior wall of the trachea. So after all this, you have to decide the patient is fit. And as we said, we examine the patient to check if the patient fit for decannulation or not. And the patient is, what is the mode of feeding for this patient? So you have to take two decisions, not one decision only. If the patient passing, no secretion, no spontaneous swallow, and laryngeal sensitivity is okay, so the patient is fit for decannulation. Okay? If the patient cannot swallow, but pass all this stage and cannot swallow the different consistency of food, so the patient is, will be fit for decannulation, but not fit for oral feeding. If the patient pass all the stage, so you can manage the oral swallowing as normal patient. And always, if you take this decision to make decannulation for the patient, and after that we start swallowing rehabilitation, always don't start immediately swallowing. So we inform them that we'll first we decannulate the patient and give him rest to the respiratory function to compensate for this different airway resistant. So after airway resistant and the patient become compensated for that, we can start swallowing, but not immediately, and because immediately the patient still in critical stage. So we have to at least wait 2 weeks to start swallowing rehabilitation. We did a study about that for endoscopic evaluation. We make auditing for our patient for about 3 years. For that, we find a patient with bedside assessment, only 18 patients was fit for the decannulation. And the remaining patient, we did endoscopic assessment. After that, who did endoscopic assessment in second visit for us, first visit, it's done by the most responsible physician, maybe ICU patient, general ENT patient, doctor, sorry, ICU doctor or general ENT doctor. So if in clinical bedside assessment, only 16% is unfit. When we do for this unfit group endoscopy, 22% of them was fit for the decannulation. So there is increase in the fitness from 18 to 31 patient. So this is significant difference between bedside assessment alone and after adding endoscopy, there increase in number. So this is valuable. And we, in this auditing, we recommend that the fees has to be done to for all patient with tracheostomy because it increase. And you know, the decannulation of tracheostomy come and decrease burden in the hospital and medical care, and the cost effectiveness is very important in this point. So to start the decannulation, the patient has reason of tracheostomy resolved, alert, responsive, consenting, patient tolerating cuff deflation for minimum 12 hours, can protect his airway, clear chest and the cuff, and the expectorate his secretion, maintain oxygen saturation, can use speaking valve or digital occlusion. And we have two types of decannulation. For this one we do is endoscopic decannulation, it's called immediate decannulation. So you can do immediate decannulation at the time. Once you examine the airway is clear and the reflex is okay, so you can remove the tracheostomy immediately. This is called immediate decannulation by endoscopic assessment. The other way is the gradual decannulation, or this is the common way, is the gradual weaning process. Gradual decannulation, we put fenestrated tube and make cabbing first few hours, then daytime, then day and night. If the patient tolerate cabbing for 48 hours, so we can remove the tracheostomy tube. This mainly time consuming, and the patient sometime feel the stress when you make cabbing because he will breathe around the tracheostomy, small air space around this one, around this area. So the patient will feel respiratory stress. So misguide the decannulation. That's why the endoscopic is more important than delayed decannulation. Delayed decannulation failed in a lot of patients, which is indicated for decannulation. As we say, so the patient will have to make the cuff deflation and capping. If there is any signs of severe upper way obstruction, like stridor, absent pre-sound, absent airflow, or respiratory stress, the patient is not fit. So endoscopic examination should identify the site of obstruction. If there is, if the patient is not fit for, if we, you make finger occlusion, the patient cannot take his breath. Why? You have to check the site of airway obstruction. Maybe subglottic granulation tissue, supratubal granulation, subtubal granulation. As we said, we see a lot of complication can prevent immediate, delayed decannulation. So also you have to check, as I said, first point is to check the size of the tube. Make the carb deflation. If the tube size, most of the patient in the regular size, you bought 8.5. This size always fitting the whole trachea. So you cannot make the carb deflation by this size. So you have to decrease to 7.5. So there is air space around the tracheostomy tube. So the patient can, you can examine this. So one of the commonest cause is the too large tube. Second is vocal fold dysfunction. We have to assess the vocal fold function, opening, closing, no spasticity. As we see also, there is some epiglottic collapse and hyperfunction larynx overall, and mainly in a spastic patient. And the patient also have different pacing sensation from, because prolonged tracheostomy, he can feel air coming from the tracheostomy only. And he forgets the feeling of the air coming from the nose and the mouth and long vocal tract. So the patient, the different resistant, is he don't have this feeling, different breathing sensation. So we can assure the patient and relax him to check exactly it is obstruction or just due to different airway resistance. So this is called intermediate step of decannulation by tracheostomy button, cap deflated tube with carb deflation, downsizing, as we said, and using speaking valve also can train the patient to feel this airway, upper airway, and improve subglottic pressure. It's called functional decannulation. Decannulation failure mainly occur in 2-5% of patient within 48 to 96 hours. The most endoscopic finding in preventing decannulation, as we see, pooling of saliva, first or silent aspiration, absence of spontaneous swallow attempts, pharyngeal anesthesia, lack of effective cuff, upper airway complication, as we see for tracheostomy, laryngomalacia, tracheomalacia, granulation tissue, stenosis, and vocal fold dysfunction. So if the patient failed in the cannulation, so we have long-term tracheostomy tube with inner cannula. The patient will be kept with permanent tracheostomy. If the patient has only sleep apnea, so sleep apnea tube, small tracheostomy tube size, surgical treatment for tracheal obstruction, vocal fold surgery, so we can manage the cause of airway obstruction. So our conclusion is the endoscopy is suitable routine method for quick, safe, and precise bedside assessment to guide the decannulation decision. Endoscopic decannulation protocol, more patient could be successfully decannulated than relying on clinical examination alone, so it must be in protocol of our hospital to make endoscopic assessment of airway and swallowing for tracheostomy patient before decannulation. And interim step decannulation is not needed in most of the case if we use this protocol. So intermediate step is not failed. But generally, a lot of physician managing this patient, so we keep the normal protocol intermediate step. If failed, we have to do the endoscopic assessment, but not to judge by this way only. If the patient failed in this way, have to enter this. As we said, if the patient examined and was unfit for bedside assessment and intermediate decannulation, and after that, when do endoscopy, 30% of them can be fit for decannulation. So endoscopy can directly observe vocal fold function and check the lower airway for obstructive lesion. So also before swallowing assessment, ensures that the patient can tolerate carb deflation and safely manage their secretion before swallowing it. Because if the patient cannot manage his own saliva, I didn't continue in swallowing assessment. If the patient has severe salivary pooling, you will not go to routine fees assessment. And bedside assessment is important, but can mislead into postponing decannulation. the most important point and the key message, don't conflate the issue of readiness to coagulation with the candidacy for initiation of oral feeding. So the patient come to you, you have to take two decisions. One, patient is ready for the coagulation or not. Second, patient is ready for oral feeding or management of his swallowing problem. routine endoscopic evaluation is necessary to identify airway obstruction for consideration, and the endoscopic protocol of the coagulation provide objective criteria that permit safe and efficient decoagulation. Thank you very much.